All right, so in the first video, we looked at a relatively simple molecule that didn't have, or that was using all of its electrons in bonding. Now let's look at a molecule, water, which is H2O, and we'll do this guy. So if we look at the total valence electrons for water, again, we have hydrogen, which has one electron, and there's two hydrogens, so we multiply that by two. Oxygen, if I'm looking at my periodic table here, I see that oxygen has eight total electrons, two of which are core electrons, for a total of six valence electrons. Oxygen has six valence electrons. So we have a total here of eight electrons. We move on to step two here, and now we have H2O, right? And remember, we said when there's hydrogens out front, they can't be the central atom because they can only be bonded to one atom, which means that oxygen must be our central atom. So we put oxygen in the center and put the two hydrogens on either side and connect them using lines. Now for our H2O structure, we came with eight total valence electrons, and here we've used four electrons in bonding. So when we subtract that, we have four electrons left over. So the next step that we need to do is to take the remaining electrons and place them around the atoms in the form of lone pairs until all the electrons are used. So a lone pair is represented by two dots. So we have our water structure. We know we have four more electrons that we need to use. So we'll put one lone pair here and one lone pair here. Now, where you put the lone pairs doesn't matter very much at this point. When we start drawing three-dimensional Lewis structures, then it'll matter, but for the time being, don't worry about that. So, now we've used the remainder of our electrons, and we're all set. So, the next thing we need to do is evaluate the octet rule, okay? So if we have hydrogen, our oxygen, the other hydrogen, and our two lone pairs here, we can look at hydrogen. Hydrogen is the exception to the octet rule, right? It can only have a maximum of two electrons, and that's because it only has that s orbital, which can only house two electrons. Each hydrogen has two electrons around it, so it's satisfied. Then we look at oxygen. Oxygen wants the full octet, so it has two, four, six, eight electrons around it, meaning its octet is satisfied. Okay. So let's look at an example of an atom that does not have a full octet and is not an exception. Okay, so let's draw this molecule. Okay. So we'll start out with the first step. We know hydrogen has one valence electron, and there are two of them. We know carbon has four valence electrons, and oxygen has six valence electrons. Again, that information all comes from the periodic table, not anything you need to memorize. So we have 10, 12 electrons total. Now, it would be hard to see here, but I'm just going to tell you that this carbon is going to be in the center. So I put the oxygen on top, two hydrogens on the bottom. Where I place these atoms around the carbon also does not matter at this point, okay? When you get into more complicated organic structures, it will matter, but for now, don't worry about it. So we use 2, 4, 6 electrons in bonding. So now we can subtract that from our total, and we have 6 electrons left over. So I'm going to go ahead and put 2, 4, 6 lone pairs here. And now we've used all 6 of the electrons. So we have an electronically correct structure. So now we need to check the octet rule. So remember, hydrogen only needs 2 electrons. It has 2, right? Both here. Oxygen needs 2, 4, 6, 8 to have a full octet. But carbon here only has 2, 4, 6, right? So carbon does not have a full octet. So what do we do in the case that you don't have a satisfied octet on one of the atoms, but you used all of the electrons? That's when you want to start moving lone pairs into double or triple bonds until all of the octet are satisfied. So here we can move this pair of electrons that oxygen is hogging over here into a double bond with carbon. So when we do that, what we get is a double bond between carbon and oxygen. We still have 2 lone pairs on oxygen and our 2 hydrogens, right? So now oxygen has 2, 4, 6, 8 electrons total around it, and hydrogen still has its 2, and carbon has 2, 4, 6, 8 electrons around it, right? So now what we're doing with the double bond is we're taking a lone pair and we're sharing it between these 2 atoms in a double covalent bond, right? Now all of our octet are satisfied, which means our structure is valid. So when you're finished making a Lewis structure, you always want to make sure that you have the very best Lewis structure. So there's a couple of things that you want to do to double check. We'll use our last molecule here as an example. So we want to go through this checklist and make sure that we have all of these things in order before we say that we're finished with this Lewis structure. So the first thing we want to do is ask, do we have the correct number of valence electrons? So if you recall, we said that there should be 12 total electrons for this molecule, right? So let's double check and make sure we still have 12. We have 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12. Check, we got that one done. So the next thing we want to do is evaluate if there's any formal charges, okay? So what the heck does that mean? Let's look at this other example here to figure out formal charges more generally. So I have this polyatomic ion, nitrite, which has 1 nitrogen, 2 oxygens, and an overall negative charge. So when I'm looking at polyatomic ions and I'm trying to figure out how many total valence electrons there are, I do the same thing I did before. I have 5 valence electrons from nitrogen, 6 valence electrons from oxygen, and there's 2 oxygens, so I have 12 electrons from oxygen. That's a total of 17 electrons, but now I need to include there's an extra electron on the overall structure, right? So I need to add that extra electron to my total. So I have 18 total electrons. Now I go ahead and put the nitrogen in the center, put the 2 oxygens around the side, and I have used 4 electrons in bonding. So I'm going to put the remaining 14 electrons around as lone pairs, right? So we've gone through all of the steps. Now we can check to see if the octet rule is satisfied. We see there's 2, 4, 6, 8 around this oxygen, 2, 4, 6, 8 around this oxygen, and 2, 4, 6 around this nitrogen, right? So that cues us into the idea that we're gonna have to share some electrons again. So which electrons you share doesn't particularly matter. I could have picked this pair or this pair or this pair or this pair, right? The only one I don't wanna pick is the one on nitrogen. The reason being because nitrogen is already the atom in the molecule that has an electron deficit, right? If it doesn't have enough electrons, then it can't share electrons. So I'm gonna share this pair from oxygen and we'll end up with a double bond here. So now we have 2, 4, 6, 8 electrons, 2, 4, 6, 8 electrons, 2, 4, 6, 8 electrons on everybody. So now we need to look at formal charge. So when we talk about formal charge, I like to draw in all of the electrons that are represented in these bonds because it makes it a little bit easier to see how we do this math. But I section off all of my atoms individually so that I can see what electrons are directly around each atom. So when we're counting for formal charges, we're not talking about the octet rule. We're not talking about how many total electrons are around them. We're talking about just the immediate electrons that are in this little box that I drew. So oxygen came to the table with 6 valence electrons. And here in the molecule, it has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 electrons. So 6 minus 6 gives us a charge of 0, right? So the formal charge on this oxygen is 0, right? We don't have to write anything for that because a charge of 0 isn't really telling us much. So now we can do nitrogen. So nitrogen came to the table with 5 electrons. Again, that information comes from the periodic table. And here I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 electrons around it for a total of 5 electrons, which I subtract for a total of 0 charges. Over here, our last oxygen still came to the table with 6 electrons, but here it has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 electrons. So when we subtract the -7, what we end up with is a -1 charge, right? So we draw a negative next to the oxygen and put a circle around it to indicate that there's a -1 formal charge on this molecule, right? Going back to this guy, right? We can evaluate it for formal charge. So I'll write in my individual electrons here, right? And I section off my atoms. So again, oxygen came with 6 electrons, and here it has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 electrons, okay? So it has no formal charge. If I look at carbon, carbon came to the table with 4 electrons, and there are 4 electrons here around it, 1, 2, 3, 4. So it has a charge of 0. Hydrogen came to the table with 1 electron each, and here they have 1 electron, so they also have no formal charge, okay? Now, the next thing that we wanna ask once we've determined if there are formal charges is, are those formal charges on the atoms that want that charge? So if you'll remember, we said oxygen is a very electronegative atom, which means that it really likes having negative charges, right? So if I'm trying to evaluate whether or not nitrogen or oxygen would rather have this negative charge, I know that nitrogen is less electronegative than oxygen, and so the oxygen would prefer to have that negative charge, right? So while there are ways to draw the structure differently, and you can play around with some of those other ways, right? This is going to be the charge arrangement that gives you the best or the lowest energy. Lewis structure. Right. So the next thing we want to check is the structure charge minimized? So here we only have one charge. We know that there has to be a charge on the overall polyatomic ion. So the fact that there's only one charge here is good. That means that we've minimized the charge. Occasionally you'll draw a structure and you'll see that there are multiple charges, but they add up to a number like this, right? Now when that happens, you never want multiple charges on an atom if possible, right? Sometimes it can't be avoided, but if you can minimize the charge by sharing electrons, you'll do that. And I'll give an example of that in another worksheet. Next thing you want to check is if there's resonance. So resonance is the ability to move these double bonds from one pair of atoms to another pair, right? So let's say I take this pair of electrons and put them back on oxygen here, right? And now I take this pair of electrons and I share it. So now I have a structure that looks like this. Now again, I have 2, 4, 6 electrons on this oxygen. So I had 6 when I came, now I have 6. That means I have a formal charge of 0. I have 2, 4, 5 electrons from nitrogen. I had 5 when I started, so that means I have no charge on nitrogen. And I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 on oxygen, which came to the table with 6, which means that there's a formal charge here. These two structures are essentially identical, right? The only thing that we're doing here is moving the double bond from one side to another, right? Anytime you can do this, this is called delocalization of electrons, right? This is one of the things that overall can minimize the energy of your structure, which is the final goal, right? We want to make sure that we have the lowest energy structure possible. If the answer is yes, then we're good to go, right? So just to reiterate, the delocalization of electrons through resonance is something that lowers the overall energy of the molecule, right? Having the negative charge be on the most electronegative atom is also something that minimizes the charge, right? So always what we're trying to do is minimize the energy of the structure.